Good afternoon, friends. Today, what I'm going to discuss is that education applications for high school students. First, on tablets or whatever it might be, there are two kinds of applications, namely core applications and web applications developed which are using web. So, core applications like the SMS program, calendar, maps, all these are also called applications. There are built-in applications, and all these applications are developed basically using Java. And there are currently total 5 lakhs apps in Android. All these apps are, these many apps are possible on Android just because that Android provides open development framework so that whatever the innovative thoughts you have, you can develop an application with that. I said two, one is called client-side application. These are developed using Android SDK, and other is web application. These are developed using web standards like HTML, XML and all those things. Actually, when we install an application, where do these applications run? Actually, these applications run in an area of operating system called sandbox. What is this sandbox is that it is an area of operating system which doesn't have access to other resources. Suppose you have installed an application. Suppose if that application takes your contacts, messages and sends to some intruder, then all your confidential information is lost. So such type of things should not happen. So the applications are running sandbox. Before installing an application itself, in Android there is called Play Store. What it does is that when you install an application, it displays all the required permissions which are need to be enabled. Suppose you want to run a game on a tablet, then it needs to enable the vibration. Some music has to come for that. So such type of permissions the Play Store will display, and the user will, is up to user to enable it or not. So in brief, if you think what is sandbox, then it's nothing but it provides security. Suppose right now, talked about the applications and where they run. Now I want to talk about what are the disadvantages of classroom teaching. And what is the disadvantage means that suppose I am teaching something and the user may not assimilate the things at that time. He may be sleepy, he may be something else. So the words and drawings of whatever the teacher says, those come only once. And if the student is not ready to accept those things, he has left something. And suppose in a large classroom, active learning is very much difficult. An instructor can't concentrate on each and every student personally. And when the instructor teaches something, he doesn't know whether the student has understood or not. There is nothing like a short quiz, all these are time waste, right? So in the classroom teaching. And suppose the main thing where a student learns is homework problems. Suppose an instructor has given a homework problem. The review of that homework problem will be given 1 week or 10 days back where the student forgets the concept itself. So there is nothing called instantaneous feedback is not there in a classroom teaching. And review questions. Suppose if online courses are there, after the course itself, 15-20 minutes of the course, you will be given a review question. Some review questions like yes or no choice, some multiple choice question, whatever it might be, can give it. So that the instructor itself can understand whether the student has understood or not. If the most of the people answered it wrong, then the instructor itself understands that something is mistaken and it has to be taught. And some more material can be given. In classroom teaching, all these are not possible. All this led to use of OLI, which is called as Online Learning Initiative, really like online courses. The motivation is that today technology is very good and it helps to it so that we can use it for education. And teachers also can use technology to enhance their learning. Learning happens, suppose if I give a homework and if instantaneous feedback is given so that the student can understand their mistakes immediately and then they get enthusiasm. If they do not get enthusiasm, then there is no point of studying. And today the costs of the colleges also are becoming huge so that the middle class families can't afford good colleges. Hence, developing of online education applications is very much important so that student can understand easily. Okay, you have developed an application. Today, suppose if I have developed an online course website, then the user may access it through via PCs, normal desktop computers, laptops, tablets or something personal digital associate, anything it might be. All for, suppose the format which I have to send to tablet is different from the format which I have to send to personal computers, because all the screen resolution is different, the formats which they display is different. And the web browser also, suppose if you take about, web browser also supports different markup languages, HTML, XML, and for mobile applications is like WML, different thing. And file formats and all are different. So So what we have to do is that for the developed electronic content, we should be able to send to different devices depending on what device they are accessing. So hence content visualization module is very much important. Suppose see, there is an e-learning shell. This is an online course website where like these courses are offered online. But this, the problem with this e-learning shell is that it can be accessed only through PCs. So what is this making? This is making the tablets useless for good things like education applications, all those things. The solution is that we have to develop a visualization subsystem so that everybody can access through the devices. Okay, then how to recognize the things. Suppose right now web browsers and servers, all those things use HTTP protocol to transfer the information on the internet. So servers can identify the particular device using a request header field in the HTTP protocol header. Using that protocol the header, in through that they can understand the through what device he is able to access it. And this is also called HTTP user agent header. What does that is, the client sends this HTTP user agent header. What the client says is that it says what type of formats it accepts and the browser it supports and different things about screen resolution, all those things. This user agent data contains the information about the browser type and the OS and the hardware, just these three things. But as the many tablets are coming, so this just user agent data is not sufficient to recognize the device. So what they have done is that they have found new thing like composite capabilities of preference profiles. What this WWW World Wide Web Documents standard says that the devices are allowed to transmit the configuration details like screen resolution, audio characteristics, what the frequency band it can accept, so that it can identify the device, and according to that device, you can send the content itself. This is this previously the HTTP protocol header we can identify user agent header, but it contains only information about hardware and operating system and the browser type. But as many devices are right now, so just that three things are not sufficient to display correctly on the tablets or whatever it might be. So World Wide Web documented new standard like composite capability, so that it displays like this. Many things are there. I have written a few. Screen resolution, audio, what kind of audio it supports and all those things. What is content adaptation approach mean? That when we are developing some content, it should be adapted to every tablet or every PC. So what does it do? Suppose it has to modification the content, like it has to compress the text, compress the images, images must be resized, some text must be formatted according to the device. All this in content approach, content will be adapted according to the device type. Suppose if the website is accessed in normal desktop computer, then no modification is required. If the same website is accessed via mobile device or something else, then all these things will happen. There are three types for this content adaptation approaches. This is called server based approach, proxy based approach and client based approach. There are three approaches for this content adaptation approach. The first one is server based approach and the second is proxy based and client based. What is server based approach? The web server will contain different modules for content adaptation. Mean the web server itself contains different, suppose the same content is there, it will be stored in one format for one device, another format for another device, another format for another device. It can be stored like that. But the problem is with this that if there are lakhs of devices, then for the same content lakhs of information is stored. This is not a good thing, this is not a good approach for thing. So what they do is that they store the information in the XML and transform it using XSLT, the transforming language is there, to transfer one same content into different types based on the devices. So I am storing the same content at the server side, but using XSLT I am getting transformed. So the device will be identified, what type of device, and then according to client's profile the content will be sent. In the proxy based approach, all these things which the server has done, the proxy will do. This is good because the server will have many other loads. So if you can do the proxy side itself, it's good. And the proxy server also captures the adapted content so that which can be used later. And the client based approach, the necessary transformation is done by the browser at the client side itself. For example, in mobile browsers, Opera software uses a client based adaptation technology. It's called small scale rendering. What is that? Is that it displays the transform the content according to the device type and display the things. Okay, visualization module means the same format will different for text, it may be different for audio, it may be different and video, it might be different. So for different things, you have to develop each module for different things. The visualization of each type requires a different approach and different type of templates must be used. The main advantage of this online teaching is that we can combine the voice and the graphics at the same time. Then the words can be linked to relevant diagrams. Suppose if I can show you some diagram here and explain it, then you can understand it easily. And if you read, instead of that, if you read a textbook, somewhere some diagram will be there, and somewhere explanation will be there. There is no animation in the diagrams in the textbook. So the, instead of studying like that, it can, this online teaching will be very much helpful. The main problem is that, if suppose I did not understand some video, there is no altered way of explanation because there is no instructor live. Only you can, if you suppose if you did not understand, then you can replay, re-forward, but if there is no altered way of explanation in these things, then what we can do is that for enhancing the learning of the students, we can pose some big problems and some frequent short questions so that we can make the students to understand better. That's what I said previously also, instantaneous assessment can be given by online learning and students can practice correct exercise and all those things so that they can learn much more things. And one more thing is that we can log the data used by the student. Suppose if the student is accessing some material many times, it means that the student did not understand that material much time. Using data mining techniques and machine learning techniques, you can identify where the student did not understand and teach that once again in a different manner. And the advantage of MOLA is that peer interaction, like if you develop a discussion forum, then one doubt can be known, the answer for a doubt can be known by all the students. And the review is also very much easy. Keystrokes, mouse clicks, everything will be logged so that data mining techniques and machine learning techniques can be applied to know where the student is feeling difficulty, and according to that some new questions can be posed or teach in an altered manner or give some additional materials so that student can understand the things very much easily. The advantage, the main advantage is that suppose if this is, suppose teacher is teaching the physics, then to explain it all these things, while the voice and the graphics both run at the same time, student can understand very much easily. Rather than in textbook, if it is this given and somewhere else explanation is given, you cannot understand whatever. Again, using animation also, if I apply 10 newtons force and 20 newtons force, how it rotates, you can show all these things. All these things are possible in online learning rather than classroom teaching and all the things. And there is one thing like learn by doing. It means that take assignment and get feedback so that you can understand where you are going wrong. And even in the homework problems, hints can be given. Suppose in normal homework problems, no hints will be given. Suppose you are stuck at the 40th step. Then at the time, if I will give an option where get hint. Then if you click that, you will be getting where you are wrong. Like that, hints can be also provided according to where you are stuck. All these things I have said, mistakes can be recognized with guidance and feedback, grade, homework. So all these are benefits of the problem. But the challenges is that lecturer cannot explain it again and again. And good interface design has to be there because throughout the world they will be accessing, suppose Stanford online courses, throughout the world everyone will access. So the user interface which you are developing should be very much good. Interaction, no personal interactions, right? Yeah, the references. And that's all. Any more questions?